this IACP event for the Australian crew. Jason Cohen and Melanie Benware and the board of directors are all getting behind this. I think it's a wonderful initiative that we're getting around the world, and we're bringing fellow ICP members on, and in this case we're bringing people from Australia. Jason, if you watch Jason Cohen in the last one, on the primary one, on the initial one that he did, he spoke to fellow people around the United States and North America. We're hoping to follow that initiative today. We've got a great lineup of guests in different regions around Australia, and we're going to be talking to them, hearing about what they're going through at the moment, how life is affecting them, what they're dealing with, whether they're a sole trader, running staff, what their business is doing, what they're doing, what their community is doing, et cetera, et cetera. So we're going to bring a great group of people in. As you can see, I've got Amy Hayward joining me on screen at the moment. I've got Scott Wendt, and I've got Bertie O'Sheedy, and I've got Jason Cohen in the green room producing and directing us from afar. What I would like to do is, Jason, if you could bring up Brent Dry, I'm going to add Brentos to the group first. So we just got an order that we're going to go through, and I'll just wait for Jason to shuffle the order around so we can bring Brentos in. And hopefully we can get him into the group. We'll probably take out Amy and leave Amy in. Sorry, we'll take out Bertie and Scott first, and we'll add Nicole, and actually leave Scott in. No, let me. So we'll take out Bertie, and we'll add Brentos in, because we're going to go Brent, Nicole, and Amy. I'll get this order right eventually. So just waiting for Brentos to, there he is. Welcome, hey. Mr. Brent Dry, all the way from Victoria.
Thanks, Cookie. Good to be here, mate.
And it's good to see you, mate. So Brentos, let's kick the conversation off with you. Before I do, representing State Line Canine, Sean and Janet Edwards, great people, love them to death. It's good to promote people that we know and love in the industry during these times. It's going to be difficult times for businesses all over the world. Melanie Benware, there's the president of the ICP. Morning, folks. Thank you, everyone, for participating. Thanks, Mel. Thanks for all your support and the wonderful job that you're doing on the ICP as the president. Really, thanks. Morning, Spuds and Bertie, from the Buffhead himself, Jason Furman. You great big Buffhead. Hey Brentos, let's talk to you. I want to we're going to jump across to everybody in this group, but Brent, let's hear how things are going in Victoria. Tell us about your business and what you and Kat are enduring right now.
Sure, mate. Thanks for having me on. Firstly, and speaking of representing, I've got Foundry Dogworks. So shout out to our brother Brandon Jolly over there in California. I hope he's going well. And
Sweaty George Clooney.
That's it. I hope obviously everyone around the world's going really well. So some strange times, and none of us have been here before. So I think just do what we can do, really, for sure. So we have a business which is called the Canine Company down here in Melbourne. We do everything from dog grooming, private consults, and our big thing, I suppose, is our group classes that we run. We have three different locations. We got an email. We've been fine up until now to continue to train. And we got an email from one of the councils. We rent ground off a council. So we got an email from one of the councils on Wednesday, and they said that all sporting grounds have closed, all sporting clubs. Anybody who leases grounds now have to cease, which is a shame, but that's our Monday night venue. So that was closed. I spoke to Business Victoria yesterday, and they said as long as we can continue to do what we are still doing, which is, you know, social distancing, which is fine, keeping our classes to a minimum of 10, which we can do because we have a large field, so we can set up groups of 10 in different areas. We put some you know, new protocols in place in regards to payment and then people coming up to reception, all those types of things. So we were pretty much good to go for the weekend, and we decided to pull the plug on our group classes, which is a terrible thing to have to do. I mean, our staff are really cool, and they generally have other, jobs that they can, like full-time jobs. It definitely puts a dent in what Kat and I are doing. But for us, the sake of the community, we thought it was the best thing for us to do. The tougher decision was, we know that a lot of people rely on us to get out and about with their dogs. So we have a beautiful community of people that we love. So that was kind of the hard call to make. And, when I put it up yesterday afternoon that we were done, and people were messaging me on Facebook or texting or calling. Like I legit had tears in my eyes. But at the moment, that's all we can do, It's it is what it is. We have a new puppy, a little Rottweiler puppy called Mr. Smith. Because we know that puppies have this critical period, we're still going to run a puppy school with all of these protocols in place. So ideally, we can continue to help puppies up until the age of 16 weeks, get the information out to the owners, have some socialization stuff with puppies. So, when all this blows over, all these puppies that are coming through, still have some level of training, still have some level of socialization and habituation. So at this stage, that's where we're at.
Mate, one thing that I credit both you and Kat at doing exceptionally well, and I know that, when I've talked to Pat on the Canine Paradigm about it, you guys are exceptional at creating communities down there, and it's just your personality and your ethos anyway. Like, you are exceptional at doing it. It's one thing that, people that know you, Brent, know and love about both you guys and what you created down there. And to add to that, the people that train with you, some of the personalities that we know, they take on that ethos as well. Like, they become those fantastic community people as well. And you really do have an amazing and lovely group of people around you. So credit to you, mate, because it's very easy when you get into the dog world to get stuck into the politics and all the jealousy and the egos that go around, and you guys seem to avoid that to a large degree, and I really respect you for it, mate. It's one thing that I've credited you for most of the time I've known you, and I really appreciate it. So keep your chin up, mate. You're doing a fantastic job. You really are a great shepherd to your flock down there, and keep doing what you're doing, man.
Yeah, thanks, buddy. I really appreciate it.
Staring at McCall saying, damn right, two of my favorite people in the world.
Yeah.
I just missed a message from Heather Beck. She said something which I missed out on. You have built an amazing community around you. Yep. Yeah. Absolutely. Yeah. Thanks, Heather.
And these are the messages that we're getting. And I'm sure, hopefully everybody in our dog training community around the world is getting similar type messages from the people that they work with and the clients that they have. Chad Mackin and I just had a chat on his podcast, Something to Bark About, came out a couple of days ago. But him and I, we spoke about group classes and those sorts of things, and the effect that a good group class can have on the community. And, that's what we've found in these times. Like, all of these people around us have really, they've reached out and they've supported us. And I know you said at the start, what sorts of things are we doing and what are we going through? We'll be doing things like Facebook Lives. We'll be putting some challenges up. I think there's a lot of how to train your dog type videos out there. I think there's, literally thousands. So I don't know if we'll add too much to that, but we'll probably do something in our own little flair. And anything we can do in regards to our community and our crew of people who we love, then we'll try and do whatever it is that we can. I think for us, the main thing, we did a little bit last night, we reached out to them and just sort of said, how are you guys going? Like, how can we help you? What do you need? And if people are doing that and they're doing it and they mean it, then I think that's a great step to sort of go forward. It's hard to do because it is an emotional thing when people actually sit there and say, hey, look, can you just keep doing what you're doing? Or, look, I'm really going to miss group classes. We have a doctor and an emergency department nurse who come down to our group classes, and they were there on Sunday, and I actually messaged them both throughout the week And I said, look, this is what we're looking at doing. You know, we still want to do classes. How do you guys feel about it? Both of them, to their credit, turned around and said, Brent, we were there Sunday. If we felt that there was an issue, then we wouldn't be there. If we felt that you were doing something wrong, then we would let you know. And I think that's the community that we have. We have open, honest relationships with each other, and you know, that's the best thing that we can ask for at the moment.
Well, I think people need to take a page from your book, mate, and replicate what you guys are doing down there, because as I said, I'm not blowing smoke up your bum. That's a Australian colloquialism. I mean it honestly. You guys are fantastic standard setters, I would guess. And I think more people need to replicate that, because you really do have a genuine kindness and a very loving open door personality with the people that attend there. So, you know, I can't thank you enough, Brent, because people like you make me want to be a better person as well. So thanks, man. Keep it up.
Thanks, mate. That means a hell of a lot to me. You know that.
Yeah, I love you, bro. You're awesome. So Brent, I might give you a little chance to have a rest there and call you back in at a later stage. But if we can shuffle Brent out and bring Nicole Smith in. I know we've got Amy and Scott waiting patiently, and appreciate that. But we'll go in the order that I wrote down, and we'll have a little chat with Nicole. You're getting good at this, Cohen. He's got the logo there. Look at that. He's even got the names going, everything. Fantastic. Hey, Nicole, welcome.
Good morning. How
hey,
are you?
I'm good. How are you?
I'm good, thank you.
How are you and your family holding up?
Yeah, we're okay. It's a bit of stressful times, but, you know, we're just riding the storm.
So, Nicole, like everybody, you know, we're in weird times. This is strange. I mean, it's surreal, and you know, it shows, I guess, for our community, it shows us what we've taken for granted. It shows us what we're limiting in access to, and how desperate we've become to, you know, just get the bare essentials in shopping centres, and the madness that's entailed. It's just so, it is, the word is surreal. And when you talk to people, you hear that echoed around the community so much. But I don't want to talk about that so much. I want to talk a little bit about you, because you've been through a couple of ordeals. We just went through horrific bushfires in Australia. And if you don't mind, I'd like you to tell the story about what happened at your property, because not only are you dealing with the COVID-19 situation, prior to that, you got hit by the bushfires. And I'd like you to tell the community a little bit about your story and how you've got back on your feet.
So, yeah, in December, so the 19th of December, we had bushfires local to us. We weren't expecting them to come past us until further on the week. That was a Thursday, so probably the weekend we're expecting the winds to change and bring them towards us. But unfortunately, out of nowhere, they appeared behind us. The first warning we got from the RFS was, seek shelter as the fire arrives, it's too late to leave. We were somewhat prepared to evacuate in respects of having all our trailers up, ready to go, hooked up to cars. We had 28 dogs, 8 cats, and my own animals and my own family. We had, by the time we got from the first message we got to driving out the driveway when our property was on fire, was about 40 minutes. Mm. So, I get shaky talking about it. But, we got out, we got all the animals out safely, and if it had been a week later, I would have had close to 100 dogs and 30 cats here for Christmas. So we just thank our lucky stars that it did come when it did come, and we all got out safely. And so we nearly lost our place. The fire was a direct path right through our property. Two RFS firemen were injured on our property fighting for our place. They were both airlifted to hospital with facial burns. Both were in intensive care for almost a week. They visited our place after they got out of hospital, and it was, really an emotional time meeting them and talking with them what happened on the day. Yeah, so that was, December. So we pretty much lost most of our Christmas trade through the bushfire coming through. We did end up opening up to a small capacity over Christmas there for almost a week.
Somebody's got an echo in the background. I think it might be you, Scott.
It is, mate.
Thanks, buddy. Keep going, Nicole. One thing I want to add there, where we're talking, is that I know a lot of people around the world saw. Yeah, we're getting feedback from someone. I'm not sure that that people really understood the magnitude of it. It was literally a scene from hell when you were watching the and I wasn't on the front line like you guys were. Like you were literally on at the wall of flame that was just consuming most of that western part of Sydney, and it was absolutely terrifying. I just went for a ride with the boys through the Bilpin area, and just to see all that area just scorched to the earth. It's just terrible how much that area got destroyed. And I mean, you went through it, and there's quite a few people that are members of our community went through it. Rachel Ratcliffe went through it as well. Paul Doyle, there's a lot of names that I can pull out, and so many people that we don't know went through just a terrifying ordeal. And I mean, I remember you sharing the pictures online and looking at, the damage that went over your property and so forth. So, how are you recovering from that now? Like, we're in between tormenting times. How are you recovering?
Yeah, we're good. Insurance company is very slow. Unfortunately, to date, we haven't had a cent from them. We're looking at probably
disgusting.
Between $300,000 to $400,000 worth of damage to our property. And we've had 5 full assessments done. And as of 2 weeks ago, they were sending another builder out to do a 6th quote. Every couple of weeks we get on the phone and email and harass them. But that's all we can do at this stage.
For a small to medium business, I mean, that is just deplorable treatment. And, the insurance companies and even anybody involved in that should be ashamed of themselves. I mean, there was so much money donated from the general public to help Australians in need and from people overseas. There was so much love and community spirit. And the fact that that is still being held, that is so shameful to them. They really need to be embarrassed about how they've handled and poorly managed that. So, I don't know what we can do to help you, mate, if we can do anything, if there's any pressure we can help put on people or as a community, would it help you?
Look, we're okay. It'd just be nice to get my property back up and fixed to where it was before this all happened, but it's just a waiting game and we're just, sitting it out and hopefully it's sooner rather than later.
So... obviously, we can talk about some of the shitty things that happened. What are you doing to lift your spirits and keep things upbeat for you and your family right now?
Just being positive, going, we'll get through it. It's tough. We've gone from, a non-peak period for us over a weekend. I'd usually have between 30 and 50 dogs here. I've got 5 dogs here today. It's stressful, but we're just keeping positive as a family. We're on 10 acres, so the kids have all got cars and motorbikes, and so we're just spending time outside, doing lots of work on the property in regards to cleaning up after the bushfire. So now that we have time on our hands, we're able to do that. Just keeping active.
Good on you. Well, love you, mate, and
Thank you.
I hope you get some peace and some resolve from that insurance claim that you well and truly overdue for. Keep your spirits up, you know, like don't forget to talk to your community. I mean, that's an important thing that we really need to remember in these times is, you know, we might be isolated but we're not disconnected from each other, you know, and I'm going to get Bertie to talk to that more when she comes in a little bit, because she's very important to our community right now. She's somebody that we should be utilizing and reaching out to. So what I will do, Nicole, is I'll say thank you very much to you now. And is there anything you want to finish up with? Any last words?
Just everyone, keep your spirits up. Talk to your friends. Talk to your family. Mm. I know we can't be physical and, you know, our visits are limited and things like that. But, yeah, just talk to everyone. Use social media as a positive and we'll get through it.
Heather Beck saying, just want to say it's fantastic to get to know and see the members in this part of the world that haven't been able to attend the conference and get to know that way. Thanks for doing this, and I hope to meet you all someday. Well, you went to conference. That's one thing that we didn't add before, Nicole. You actually got to go to conference in Colorado. So we got to hang out and party, and you got to network and meet some of the people over there. And you went over there with Tegan, who's now working for me at Pet Resorts, and or Canine Evolution, I should say. So, you know, fantastic. And hopefully we'll be able to get you back over there again to hang out with us. Absolutely. It was good to see a group of Aussies over there. Scotty was supposed to come over, but he had the pike, unfortunately. Not his fault, but we'll let him talk about that. We'll let him talk about that in a little bit. So, Nicole, thanks, mate. Keep your chin up.
Thank you.
You know, too. Reach out if you need to. We're here for you, and you know, we'll talk in the future. So, Jason, if you wouldn't mind, thanks, Dale. Jason, if you wouldn't mind taking Nicole out, and what I might do, we might jump Jessica in front of Bertie, because I think we'd like to end with Bertie. I think Bertie would be a good wrap up for the show. So, Amy, we're going to talk to you, and because you've just kicked off a little training business, and you just had Damon Jennings design you a cool new logo. Which I can see you wearing on your T-shirt there. So tell us about your little business that you've got going.
Yeah, firstly, thanks for having me on, Glenn. Appreciate it.
Thanks for joining us.
I'm located in Adelaide, so running a business called Epic Dog Training and Adventures. So basically what we do is take dogs out on adventures. We do private home consults and we do some pet sitting as well. And when I say we, it's just myself at this stage, so just a sole trader, which makes things a little bit easier during this difficult and weird time. So it's very strange here. I personally haven't been too affected compared to other people by what's going on. Our adventures are still running as usual because obviously we're not in human contact or anything like that with those. I'm quite fortunate I have keys to people's houses and just go and pick up the dogs and take them to, you know, various places where there isn't a lot of people around. As far as pet sitting goes, we've had obviously a lot of cancellations and things like that. But I'm quite lucky again in my clients are fantastic and a lot of them have chosen to maintain their credits with me and use them at a later date. So that's obviously helped a lot financially for myself. But we're just trying to abide by all the rules, keep running as much as we can while we can.
Well, I got to hang out with you a little bit in Adelaide when Narelle and I were down there with Jackie and Alicia, which was fantastic. It was a really it was a great scene down there in Adelaide, and I've said it a couple of times, and I really mean it, is that Adelaide are really starting to raise the bar on their involvement into the canine community, because for the people who are joining us in North America or around the world, wherever you are, the eastern coast of Australia was very dominant in, and still predominantly is, it's very dominant in the dog world of what we're doing. And it's really great to see the other states really starting to step in right now. So South Australia, Western Australia, you know, we've got a great crew over there. We had Ben Gertz on the Canine Paradigm a while ago, and him and various other people are doing wonderful things. And, you know, yourself and, as I said, the dog workshop, the entire crew down there, they're doing a great job. So I managed to have a chat with you, Amy, and I told you when we're out the back, and I mean this, and I'm going to say it publicly too. I was watching some of your videos that you're doing with your own dog, some of your training you're doing, and you're doing some really impressive work. You know, I really think that you've got a great career in this industry if you keep doing what you're doing. So, you know, keep up the good work because you're really on the right pathway.
Yeah, thanks, heaps. Like I said, it means a lot coming from you. Obviously, as the one that was my mentor and that when I did NDTF, so you kicked me out the nest, as we like to say. I'm really enjoying what I'm doing, and I think that's probably the most important part of all of this. I enjoy every aspect of it, you know, being with people, being with the dogs, you know, continuing my learning, all of it has been awesome. So thank you.
Got a few people joining us from Adelaide that are saying, Donna Golding saying, so appreciative of Glenn and Narelle visiting us in Adelaide. Well, thanks to Jackie and Alicia and the crew down there for inviting us along. People like that, you know, and that's a good thing to see is there's some seminars being available. And as I said to the crowd down there, and I mean this entirely, it doesn't matter who the seminar is or where you are around the world. If you get opportunities to educate yourself and further your education, you know, jump on board, guys. Please, you know, remember that this is all a part of the journey. Some things will be amazing. Some things will be great. Some things, you know, some of the seminars will be things that you might have already heard, but you'll always take something away from it. It's a great opportunity to expand your portfolio of information, everything that you can add to your experiences. So, Amy, you're also getting involved in GRC, I believe.
Yes. Yeah, we're hosting Jazz here, hopefully, in June, I believe. But everything's kind of up in the air for now, so it's all pending, which makes it tricky because you don't know how much to push it, whether it's going to go ahead or not. So, Jazz has been a good support as always, so we're keeping in contact with her in the meantime.
You're referring to Jazz Whiting, who I affectionately nominate as Sweats.
Correct.
Who is heading up GRC. She's been studying it under Jay Jack and Mandy over in Maine and doing an absolute fantastic job. I know, you know, we're all very proud of her. She's really stepped up her game, and she is a fantastic community leader in GRC. Jack Kennedy saying, kicking goals, Amy Haywood. So,
thanks,
yeah, it's great to see that you're on board. I know, you know, I was speaking with Jazz a while ago, and she was talking about how impressive some of your work is. So, as I said, keep going. You're heading in the right trajectory. It's very important to have people like you out there, because as younger people start coming into the industry, you know, it's very good that they're going to keep high standards and be able to keep it going and even do a better job than what we were doing. You know, as information's getting better, so too does the level and the standard of training that's getting passed along out there.
Yeah, absolutely.
Anything else, Amy? Anything else you want to share with us? How are you keeping your spirits up while you're locked into isolation?
Yeah, look, just trying to stay positive, stay busy. I'm not really one that likes to sit still. So all those posts going out saying, you know, we make our dogs sit and stay, but we can't do it. Guilty. I'm one of those people. So, you know, lots of time in the yard yesterday. I was sifting dirt to get, you know, hay and stuff from other animals out of it and all sorts of weird things just to keep my mind busy. We're also doing a post on the Epic Dog page, just trying to keep the community accountable with their training and stuff during this time. So each day it's, you know, post a photo of your dog doing a drop outside. So promote people getting outdoors, you know, front yard, backyard, getting that vitamin D and stuff in, because I think that's really important, you know, mental health and things like that. So just trying to keep people still involved with training their dogs as much as we can, given the circumstances. And, yeah, just reaching out to clients. And I've had lots of clients reaching out to me, which is really lovely. It's nice to know how supported you are during these times. And, you know, my partner and I are in a position, we're renting our house at the moment. We have for many years now, and it was nice even just to get a message from our landlord just saying, you know, whatever happens, you guys will have a roof over your head. So, you know, that's one thing you don't have to stress about. So just little things like that, I think, make all the difference during this time. So, no, it's been
what an awesome person.
Very fortunate.
Kat Saunders, Brent's wife, just posted that you're a rock star.
Thanks, Kat.
Rock star Amy Haywood, Kat Saunders.
Cheers.
Yep. As I was saying before, you know, Kat and Brent are a very important part of our community, and they've been over to Adelaide several times, you know, sharing their wisdom and their insight as well. So it's we're very fortunate to have fantastic people like that in our community, especially at this time when we need those people.
Absolutely.
Hey, Amy, thank you for joining us. I really appreciate it. I'm going to park you in the green room. And we've got Alex Edwards, who was late to the party. I'm going to park him in your spot. And then I'm going to cross over to Scott Wendt, who's been sitting there from the start patiently. And we're going to have a little chat to Scotty Boy, who I've only got to know him more recently. But Scott has – you can tell them about your business, Scotty, and what you're doing. But that – well, I'll tell my version of – well, not my version, my input to your business after you give people a little bit of an insight onto who you are and what you're doing. So welcome, Scott Wendt to the conversation.
Thanks, Glenn. Good on you, mate. Thanks for having me.
You're welcome. Thanks for joining us.
Interesting times ahead for us all.
Mm. So tell us a little bit about your business, mate, and your injection into the dog into the canine community.
Okay, so we own homestead boarding and training kennels in Wonga Park in Melbourne. And I know you have a bit of history there as well, Glenn, so we've declared an interest. So we took over the business 3 and a bit years ago from Rod, who you had the pleasure of working for many years. Rod is retired, so my wife and I took over the business. We're a pretty large facility. We can hold circa 300 pets.
Yep.
And we train around 450 board and train dogs a year since
And you're
we
in
started.
A beautiful part of Victoria.
Yeah, look, we are very fortunate. We've got 15 acres of property and it's lots of fresh air and it's just fantastic. So we've been focusing on the board and train that we've been doing successfully now for a few years. We're training sort of around 450 a year and we're boarding, you know, just normal cat and dog boarding is sort of, you know, we've got an average occupancy of, you know, 150 every day. That's dropped pretty rapidly down to about 20 over the last few days. We still have 15 or 16 board and train dogs still here that we're still working with. Unfortunately, we've had to stand down most of our fantastic staff, and that's just a heartbreaking thing because it's, you know, as I said, you do feel like the executioner putting them up against a wall, and it's just the worst thing from a management perspective to be sleeping with that every night and waking up in sweats during the night just going, like, this feels like a bad dream.
If you manage to get to sleep.
If you manage to get to sleep, absolutely. So, look, we're just battling on. I still have two of my full-time trainers here working through the remainder of the dogs that we have. Easter's just now a write-off. And our customers have been outstanding. As a community, we've got a lot of loyal, very loyal customers, and a lot of them have been reaching out and even ringing us, offering us money. You just can't believe it.
Wonderful.
We've refunded every deposit because we're not the only ones doing it tough. There's lots of mums and dads out there that are as well.
That's so right.
We don't keep deposits. We just keep rolling, and we'll be, most importantly, be here at the other end of this to make sure that we can serve our clients and all our staff have got a place to come back to. I mean, ultimately, you know, they've got to come back.
That's the important thing, Scott, is it's a very difficult time and it's incredibly demanding on the aspect of being a business owner during this time. But the actions that we take now will be remembered in the future by the people in our community. So the way that we're behaving is, I think Pat mentioned this the other day, and it's a very sage or a very poignant point and very sage advice is, if we act badly now, people are going to remember us forever about it. You know, because this is not just, and it's very easy to feel insular about this at this time. You know, it's very easy to feel that we're encapsulated in our own bubble of sorrow and misery with what's happening. But the fact that I have to keep reminding people is, you know, this is happening everywhere in the world, and it's kind of unthinkable because it's just something that we've never had to endure before, and we don't know a lot about. But we're finding out stories and we're hearing things from every corner of the world on how people are finding life with this issue of being locked up or told you can't do what you're normally free to do. And, you know, like you, buddy, like just like you, you know, we were talking while we were off air. You know, you do feel like the executioner, that you're lining people up against the wall and you're executing them, and it's a
look, it's a shocking thing. And at the end of the day, of really just focusing now on our mental health, because we've got to be here to support our staff and our customers when we get through this, and we will get through this. This is, I'm confident that if we can stay busy, like I'm really focusing now on some marketing initiatives in the digital space, just to keep ourselves busy and keep the community knowing that we're there for them. At the end of the day, I had an older customer ring up and she was vulnerable, and I went and picked her cat up and just brought it here. And, I'm happy to do that and not charge people. We're a community here. We're a very, Wonga Park. It's a very clicky little community.
It is a beautiful part of the world.
Yeah, and
Melanie's welcoming you, mate. She's saying, welcome, Scott, and thanks for being so patient.
Thanks, Mel. Yeah, so we're just sticking fat. Our customers are fantastic. Yep. We've just got to make sure that we are here and we maintain some form of terrific mental health in this time, and support the community, support each other, just talk to each other, open dialogue, and we will all get through it. It's I know we will. But our mental health is so important at this time, because it's very easy when things – you're so used to working at a frenetic pace to drop back to nothing. It can really affect you from a depression perspective. And I've definitely had some days recently where I've felt, pretty ordinary, but you've just got to dust yourself off and keep going, because – and having people to talk to that are in the same situation as us, both nationally and globally. There's a fantastic community of trainers – down here in Melbourne that, we've referred some business to, because they do a great job, and it's important to keep everyone going in these times.
Well, as you mentioned before, Scott, Melanie saying, yes, Glenn, 100%. I talk about that in my next president's letter for the Canine Professional Journal. How we conduct ourselves now will be remembered. Let's show our best. I think they're perfect words to echo throughout our community.
I think it's going to be what's going to define us at the other end as a community, as an individual, as a business, will be how we deal with everything today. And I'm such a big believer in that, yeah.
Cohen, can you put up – Emily put up something before. I think that was quite, something profound that we need to think about as well. Emily, yeah, that's the one. Important to keep the canine community together and healthy physically and mentally right now. Yeah, absolutely. Beautiful words, Emily. I think that's – yeah, it's definitely sage advice also. Mate, you and I recently met. We went to a conference for the Pet Industry Association of Australia. Yep. About a year ago now, I think, wasn't it?
It was in August, August 2019. Yeah.
And that was the first time I met you. I'd spoken to you a few times and, like we've talked about things in the past, but it was the first time I got to meet you. And you're right, we share some common ground, because I used to run my business at a homestead under Rod when he owned it. And I never thought he would sell that business. I was convinced that he would just walk into the car park and just keel over one day. That was Rod through and through. Marcy Davies is joining us. Yep, actions now to keep the community safe. People have been disappointed, but so understanding, and know we'll get through this and come out the other side shining. Yeah, sage advice also. Marcia's also been a fantastic help to our community. She is one of my admins on the Balance Symposium, and one of the people that really keeps that community alive as well. She keeps a close eye on it and is really managing things so well. So, Marcia, thanks for all your help as well. You've been a great shepherd in this community as well. Scotty, back to you. We share common ground. I worked there for many, many years. And let me say, buddy, that you are the right man to take over that business. Your energy, your compassion, and your love to taking it to the next level. That's great to see, mate, because, although Rod did what he could with the place, I think you've really punched through the ceiling there, and you're going to take Homestead Kennels in Wonga Park in Victoria. I think you're going to take that place to a new level where it really needed to go, mate. So congratulations on taking over that business. And, mate, you're a gentleman. It was a fantastic to get to know you. I hope to get to know you better. And please stay connected to the community. Don't let the – this is a very trying time for many people in many businesses. And, you know, boarding kennels are people that are really feeling a kick in the stones right now. So stay strong, brother.
Yeah. Yeah, thank you, mate, and thank you for everything you do for the canine community too, mate. I know I've said it to you before, but it's great to have people like yourself that advocate for the community as a wider thing. So, mate, thank you, and I appreciate you having me on, mate.
Thank you, buddy. I really appreciate those words.
Keep well.
Thanks, man. So we're going to swap Scotty out. Thanks for your patience, buddy, all this time, and appreciate you joining us. And we're going to we've got Alex there, and we're going to jump Bertie Oshidi, and we're then going to have a chat with Jessica. Hey, Jess, how are you? How's life? So Jess, tell us about where you are in the neighbourhood and what you're doing and how you're keeping well in these times.
Yeah, so I'm from Yay, Victoria. And we're on 5 acres here in a little farming district. And we've got a lovely little country town, a very, very supportive town. It's great to see everyone connecting with the community and just supporting each other. That's helping us get through. So my family, I'm at home with my little girl and homeschooling her here. We've just now come to the school holiday, so we've slowed down the schooling, and now we're just concentrating on upgrading our property, and that's what's helping us get through. So just staying busy and proactive in. So we've, you know, had to close down work from out in the community. So I work as an assistance dog trainer, and my business is called Assistance Canine. I'm actually a sole trader at the moment. And now that things have slowed down, it's a time to be able to look at other areas and look at how things can be improved and streamlined. Yep. So I've been becoming a paperless business, and that's going to help operations later. I've become just moving towards being an organisation since demand was becoming higher for assistance dogs. I had a waiting list, and now that things have come to a slowdown, it allows time to be able to focus on just moving forward in the future. So been working on framework, so establishing a good solid framework to be able to support clients that come in, and support current clients as well. So how we're able to support current clients is through using Zoom, so Zoom app, and just having regular contact with people, making sure that they're okay. Because there's, you know, some clients are alone, they don't have family, they don't have people close by that can support them, they don't live with people. So sort of becomes more than being a dog trainer working in the assistance dog role. It's very much person-centered more than anything. And, you know, being in the times that it is, some people will be a lot more vulnerable and look to support. And working as an assistance dog trainer, you sort of put in that position of absolute trust, where there's no sort of no judgment, so people turn to us for support, and I've been getting a lot of people just wanting to reach out. So that's a time that it's time to step up and just support people. But to be able to do that, I've got to be on my game. I've got to be my best to be able to support others. So, self-preservation comes into it. And how I'm dealing with that is doing things that are helping me. So working in, improving things at home. Our home environment is very much my work environment. There's not a lot of money to go around at the moment. So just using what we have, what resources we have on the property to be able to upgrade projects. So at the moment, we're upgrading our kennels. So that will allow more of a capacity for dogs coming in for assistance dog training through programs. And that will allow a small breeding program when we get back on our feet. We're at the moment just writing a public education program. So I'll be working with Public Transport Victoria and doing an education campaign later in the year or whenever, is possible to be able to bring about assistance dog awareness, for businesses and for the public and handlers. There's a lot of work involved in that, but I'll be able to bring handlers in to be able to help with those education programs. So there's lots and lots of things to look forward to. There's another project that working on with creating a line of some dog training equipment. So bringing in a line of assistance dog wear and gear. So it'll be custom made wear, collars, leashes, all that sort of stuff. That's pretty exciting, really good quality stuff. In the future, going forward, I'm just waiting on an accreditation that I recently applied for. I know that that'll be put back now, but the guiding and assistance dog accreditation through the Queensland government, that's going to be a real waiting time now. But at the moment, the focus is on just seeing what we can do to improve things now going forward. It's a good time to catch up on things that we haven't otherwise been able to. So, it's been pretty productive, but it's been a bit of treading water as well, just trying to stay sane.
Sorry, Jess, just give me 2 seconds. Narelle's left her speaker on and it's blasting through the roof, so I had to mute my microphone while you were talking so I didn't interrupt you. Hang on 2 seconds.
Okay, no worries.
Well, that's absolutely fantastic, and there's an old adage that I'm very much aware of, and I try and exercise myself to the best degree that I possibly can, and that is that idle hands are the devil's tools. And I think that if we're not keeping busy during these times, that it's a precursor for poor mental health and also for, coming up with some bad ideas. So it's great to see, and it really is encouraging to see how many people in the community are thinking, okay, so during this time when life is paused, what can I do to get myself ready for the other side of it? What can I do to change the dynamic? And it sounds like you've got a lot on your plate and you're keeping yourself very busy. So fantastic. I reckon that's marvelous that you've prioritized that there is a bunch of things that you can be doing to shuffle yourself into getting ready for when things kick back up again. Because the gears are going to start winding back up. So, rather than everybody just dropping into a heap, you know, and get and sitting into a corner covered in cobwebs. You know, we've just got to keep remembering there is things to do. There is preparations to organise. You might be at home, but there's you know, you can reshuffle things. You can adjust the way that you're thinking about, and that's the great message that the community is trying to help each other get through is, you know, find something else to do, look online, be inspired by what other people are doing. And, you know, something I said to my staff in a meeting the other day is come to me with ideas, because everything around us started with an idea. You know, when you look at the concept of this video chat, this was somebody's idea. Facebook was Mark Zuckerberg's and several other people's idea. And it came from frustration, some of it. It came from trial and error. And, you know, these are things that change the world sometimes. With great pressure, great diamonds are produced. So good on you, Jessica. It's really encouraging to hear that you've got some great things on the forefront, and congratulations, well done. Keep your spirits up.
Yeah, on the horizons, they're looking forward to the other side.
Wonderful. Hey Jess, I'm going to ask Jason Cohen if he wants to jump in and join us. I'm going to switch over to Alex Edwards, who was late to the party as usual, a big buffhead. Alex is a longtime friend of mine, and also to the greater dog training community, another person I think does wonderful work trying to lift the spirits in our community. He's a guy that never rests. He's always in some part of the world learning new material. Jason is the sort of person that I think others need to, again, you know, when we talk about taking leaf out of people's books, people are great in their own right and reason. What I do love about Jason, the point I'm trying to get around to is, you know, I see him attending other people's seminars. Instead of trainer bashing, he's actually out there promoting and encouraging the community. He was just over recently in San Francisco, I think, with Michael Ellis doing his school again for another round of that. He promotes local talent. He gets involved in it himself. He's always in a part of Australia or somewhere around the world, hosting his own little seminars and stuff like that. And Alex, please, welcome to the show, mate. Thank you for joining us. Tell us what you're doing. How are you keeping?
Hey, guys. Yeah, I'm keeping pretty well at the moment. It's been a weird couple of weeks for me. I was over in San Fran with Mike Ellis for a couple of weeks, hanging out, training some dogs with him. And then I was sitting at the airport 20 minutes before I jumped on my plane to fly back to Australia, and they announced the quarantine lockdown. So I got to fly home and pretty much 8-hour deadline of I was past to sit in quarantine for 2 weeks when I get home. So I've had 2 weeks of sitting around feeling great and getting a heap of stuff done around here, and just sort of re-gearing the way I run my business a little bit as well. So there's going to be an online platform that I'm gearing up to do, and doing a heap of work on my acreage as well. So that never ends. Then the logistical nightmares of trying to re-juggle and shuffle seminars and stuff like that. Mm. So I had a seminar in Brisbane in April that we've had to postpone now, which is kind of annoying and a little bit tricky, but it is what it is. So we pushed that back to July, and hopefully by then everything's cleared up a little bit. But a lot of it is just watch and wait. And then I've got Pat down here as well, and we have to wait and see what happens with Pat now. So there's always something happening.
Melanie Benware, Alex Edwards, the best wolfhead and husky guy. Well, I think Jason Furman is the best wolfhead, but Alex Edwards is they're both racing tadpoles, both of them. Who let that Jason Cohen guy back on? What's that? What's IMBO mean?
Limbo.
Limbo, okay. Yeah, I'm hearing you, Alex. Next weekend, Narelle and I were supposed to be in Brisbane doing a seminar, and you know we were heading up there, and unfortunately we had to pull the pin just after we got back from Adelaide. And you know, most people were understanding. A few people were a bit disappointed, but I think hopefully they'll understand a little bit more, because you know we were getting really early heads up that things were starting to transpire into a whole new level. So I just spoke to the organizers and Sue War up there, and I said to Sue, look, you know, I really think for the safety of everybody, not just Narelle and I, but for the safety of everybody, I really think that we should look at this. And she was right on it. She was very supportive, And, yeah. You know, it's a pain in the neck for a lot of people because, oh, Furman's on. Oi, watch yourself, corpse man.
I have no idea what that means.
He's having a go at me because I'm so white. LMBO means laughing my bum off. It's not limbo.
Oh,
thanks, okay. Carolyn, for clearing that up. So yeah, what else is going on, mate? How's Holly? How's the little farmlet going? Tell us all about that.
Yeah, the zoo's going. So we've got a ton of animals here. So we've got sheep, goats, alpacas, baby lambs, the dogs, chickens, guinea fowl. I'm going to forget something in the list of things. So we got a new dog, Littlefoot. We got him probably about 3 months ago now, but I hadn't had really much of a chance to do any training with him because I've been traveling so much. So he's going to be the dog that we're using for most of our videos and stuff like that we put on our online platform. Just he knows nothing, so it's a great time to start teaching him some stuff and having some fun with him. So he's getting some training done, doing work with all the dogs. Then, yeah, there's just stuff happening around the zoo all the time. So Holly's phone hasn't stopped ringing from people wanting to buy chickens and veggies and stuff like that off her, so she's pretty stoked about that. But
because you've got the organic gardening going, haven't you?
Yeah, so she's got her own organic business that she runs. So we grow all the stuff on our property. So she's getting around wearing a mask and gloves and full extremist, but people are coming to pick up boxes of veggies and stuff. So it keeps her busy. She's loving it. It's been tricky having been quarantined. She's been staying at a neighbor's place the last 2 weeks pretty much. So she comes and does her gardening and we've had her isolation from each other. So it's just been weird. So, yeah, it's a weird time, but it is what it is. So me and all my neighbors, we look out for each other pretty well. So we're... As soon as anyone needs a hand with anything, you know, if it's she went and did it. Holly did a food run the other day and got some stuff for some neighbors. So we're all looking out for each other. And I think that's all we can do to get through this is, you know, Absolutely. We support each other and we just try and keep the wheels turning. And I've been referring dogs left, right, and center to other trainers I just can't get to. And we don't know how long it'll be till someone can get to go see those dogs. So it is just a weird little juggling act. But as long as we sort of stick together, I think we'll be all right when we get through this. It's just the waiting game and when at this point in time for us. So,
well, that's another thing I really admire about you, Alex, is that you've really got good spirits all the time. Like I don't think I've ever seen you where you've been grumpy or downtrodden or anything like that. You really manage to keep your spirits high. How do you do it? What's the secret?
Yeah. I never stop. I just keep rolling with the punches. You know, you've got to be productive. You don't get anywhere sitting on your hands and doing nothing. So, you know, you rest your ass. So I just don't want to run into that. So there's always things to be done, though. You know, you've got books that you've brought. You've ordered DVDs and stuff like that that, you know, you leave there, do those sales and you buy all this stuff you don't need. And, you know, these are the perfect times to go through and just continue your own learning. Even if you can't get out and be training dogs, you can still learn from stuff. So there's an abundance of stuff online now that everyone can sort of bounce and network off each other. And
absolutely.
I've got clients calling me daily and I'm filming things and sending it to them just to keep them rolling. So it's, you know, there's no reason why we need to stop the world turning at this point in time when we've got so much social media and stuff like that. We can bounce things backwards and forwards and podcasts 100%. And stuff like that. So, yeah.
Mm. So, well, yeah. The, you know.
Yeah, like, just look forward to positive things. Have goals.
If we turn on the news as we always do, I mean, there's a million and one terrible stories out there, but
yeah.
I think sometimes we need to turn it off and we need to concentrate more on this because
I
yeah, well, you know, I keep telling everybody I'm getting old these days and I was born in the era of the 70s when there was an Australian band called the Skyhooks and they wrote a song about the terror on the news called Horror Movie. And that, you know, pretty much sums up that every time you turn on the TV, it's a terrible story. And what I'm trying to convince people to do and encourage people, I know Birdie will probably talk, she might talk about this or something, whatever she wants to, but what we really need to encourage the community to do is look at the hopeful side of the breakthroughs that people are having and the good stories that are going on. And that's why I said, mate, I love your upbeat attitude. You know, even Cohen before he was saying, you know, Alex has got a really chipper attitude and he really knows how to keep his spirits high. And that's, you know, that I think that comes from great self-discipline and that's just a personal thing because, you know, there's plenty you can all look, COVID-19, bushfires, there's always something to be miserable about. But there's always something to be positive about too. There is a brighter side to life. You know, Monty Python sang a song about it called Always Look on the Bright Side of Life. And I think that during these times, that those are, you know, that's great advice to follow. There is good advice. So, Alex, we're running into overtime here. So before we switch over to Birdie, any closing words, mate? Anything that you want to tell the community?
Just look out for each other. Do the right thing. Stay positive. You know, there's always something you can learn at this point in time, you know, and whether it's just better management for things in the future or whatever it needs to be. But just look out for each other. Try and make sure you get outside a little bit. Have a laugh every day about something stupid that's inappropriate, whatever you need to keep
exactly.
your day rolling.
And keep those memes coming, Katrina Hartwell.
That's it. The meme queen.
The meme queen.
So, yeah. But, yeah,
sorry, man, I interrupted you. Keep going.
Keep in the loop with everyone as well. Like, I'll be Skyping with Josh Moran in the next couple of days. Justin Hall's called me a couple of times from Atlanta. Like, it's a good time just to catch up with mates as well from the outside world and share a beer. So, just look out for everyone.
One thing that Cohen's doing, Jason Cohen, who's at the bottom of our screen right now and our host and producer, he's doing virtual dinners with some of his colleagues. So Byron and the Visconis. So he instead of just eating dinner alone, he gets on his computer and does this type of thing, which I think is amazing. I really loved it. I just thought, what a beautiful thing. You know, like in that time that they're all sitting down having a meal together and having a laugh as a community. Jason, that is just incredible, man.
And we did it simply through like a Facebook group chat. You just click the video button and brings everybody together. It's that easy. Lots of fun, lots of laughs. That's it.
Alex, thanks, buddy. I'm going to jump to Birdie now. So if you don't know who Birdie is by now, you must be living under a rock. She's a person that Pat and I have so much time for. Not just Pat and I. There's hundreds of people who really do well from Birdie's friendship and her genuine love. And Narelle and I are recipients of that very frequently, and we appreciate her so much. She's one of the most genuine people I've ever met.
What's that?
No, seriously. Seriously. I mean, you know, like you get people through some very tough times, Birdie, and you know, like you're very important to our community, and especially times like now. So this is why I want to wrap up with you. So welcome. Thank you.
Welcome, everybody. I can hug you like this. I can't, like, I'm not, you don't want to have a hug too, but at least I can't. I see you and I hear you. It's like, yes. When we did the podcast the other time, it was really weird not hugging your loved ones. So I'm like, hey, you know, like, I think it's a time where love is what we have to do. And, you know, being heard and seen is a way to show love to someone, you know, whether it is through dinner parties or having a coffee together. Like, I call people and we have a coffee together, like a coffee catch-up online. But there was already so much great advice on here, and I think this is the main message.
Shut up, Herman.
I think the main thing here is at the moment that we are kind to other people and to ourselves. Everyone is stressed. Thank you, hugs, Beth. That we are kind to each other, not just in ourselves. Like, I think this is a real testing time that the way you behave to other people is very often the way you behave to yourself. And I think it's so important that we at the moment, we see and we hear people, because being seen and heard is a way of acknowledging, hey, I have love for you. I see you.
Yep.
And I think that can be done in a very simple way. You don't have to have solutions for people at the moment, because not even a world leader's have solutions. It's very often just, I got time for you. And time at the moment is, we have time.
Yep.
Time is at the moment something that's available. So I think
Melanie,
it's really
loves
important.
You.
I love Melanie too. that we actually see this, like, we have to make this mental commitment at the moment to see this coronavirus not as an enemy, but our isolation, the way we introduce ourselves to other people, the way we handle ourselves is an act of love. You know, like, Alex going into isolation and not seeing his girlfriend, that's an act of love, because he's like, well, I want to protect the people I love. You reducing your sociality is an act of love if you don't hurt your community. So instead of fighting it and always focusing on the fear or on the anger towards the situation, focus on what can actually do good. You know, is that
like my husband, we just moved house. Like, I'm really glad that you only see a tiny bit of my screen because my house is an absolute mess. My brain seems full with paints and eyebrows. Like, you see the best part of my house at the moment that we just moved in. But I think you have to adapt in these times. Like, you know, I'm quite a perfectionist, so I can't be a perfectionist right now. Or we have to think about, okay, I'm quite fit and active, so my husband and I line up for the supermarket for our elderly neighbors and we cook for them, or we get them toilet paper because Australians are pretty crazy at the moment with their toilet paper purchases.
Yeah, aren't they?
Yes, absolutely. I think it's really important at the moment to make a decision of, hey, who am I? If life comes push to shove, who am I? What's the best version of me going to do? Are you going to be kind and loving to each other, or are you going to suffer? Are you going to be mean? Are you going to be greedy? And the challenging thing is that you won't be able to be positive all the time. Like, if you look at the strategies that people have to do to stay resilient, would be one of them definitely would be having to be in the present moment. That's the only gift you really have in life. You can't change much of the past. You don't know much about the future. So really practice coming back in the present moment.
Sorry, Brady, just before, sorry to interrupt you. Somebody's mic is really causing a lot of, there's a lot of distortion.
I'm trying to see.
I can hear a lot of wind.
Scott's
blowing.
Muted. Nicole's muted. Brent's muted. Amy's muted. Jessica's muted. I don't know. And it's just us.
Sorry, Bertie, keep going.
Oh, all good. I'm just saying that being in the present moment is also the most hardest thing for people because obviously these times are hard teachers. You know, this is not a gentle teacher. You basically literally just within a very short period of time, you have to adapt. And it hasn't been done before. Like there's no reference on how to do this. Like bushfires, we had a reference. Now we don't. Mm. So right now I think it's really important that you start becoming mindful about, hey, what type of thoughts am I having? The challenge here is that you accept and acknowledge what you're going through without drowning in these emotions and in these thoughts. But you will have anxiety, you will have doubt, you will have fear. So don't push those emotions down, but just gently hold them and go like, yeah, I see you. But I can't do much more than I can. Like right now, all I have is what can I do in this minute, in this hour, in this day? And I think it's really important that people, especially if you're prone to mental health issues, that you stick to a schedule and a routine. You know, it might be fun to stay in your peaches the first 2 days, but then you have to get back into life.
Mm.
Stick to some exercise if you can. Get some fresh air. Get some vitamin D. Make sure that, like, I love junk food. Like, when I look at my pantry, if I could go shopping in what I would like to have in my pantry, it's very different to what I should be eating to stay healthy. So, you know, make healthy choices. Be aware of, hey, how much alcohol am I drinking? How much am I smoking? That you have actually, that you give your body and your soul the resilience to cope because you need it. We don't know what the timeline is. We don't know what we're going to have to do. So be aware of making the best out of the present moment. Does that make sense?
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah. And I think that's what Alex already is talking a lot about.
Justin, you goose. Sweat in the present.
Well, that's also an option.
Tamara, Abby, think like a dog, be in the moment.
Yes. But you have to have this ability to also set yourself up for the future. You know, you have to have, you can't just be like this hardcore person that only thinks about right now. You do have to have foresight. You have to be aware of consequences. And right now, probably delayed gratification plays a big part. Because what you're doing right now might not fruit for a while. So it's really important that whatever your mind or your body and your soul is processing is whatever you feed with your attention, that's what's going to grow.
Mm.
If you feed avoidance, you will come out of it and it will be overwhelming. If you're obsessing about it and you're trying to control everything, you will also not be okay. because obsession and over controlling and avoidance, they're all based on anxiety. So right now it's literally about what's good for me, what feels wise, what feels nurturing and wholesome. Another point that is really important is that you accept your emotions right now. And they can be very simple. They can go like, oh, I'm a bit anxious today. Oh, I'm a bit angry today. Oh, I have to do things that I actually don't want to do, like having to pour stuff. That's a really, really unpleasant thing to do right now. So yep. I think instead of toughening up and go like, nah, I can't do that, go like, yeah, I feel this, and you can share that with people, how hard this is actually for you, and that you can, that they see that you are not liking doing this. I think that's really important, that you're not cold right now. And sometimes it's just naming an emotion what it is. Like, I was very anxious yesterday. We had a lot of changes in our life yesterday. Nothing, like everything is manageable, but they add up. Like small changes, they still accumulate over time. And yesterday there was a day where I'm a bit like, oof, there's a lot of change coming. And then it's like, all right, I have to be gentle with myself today. I might be slower. I might be less productive. I might need more walks with my dog. So that you acknowledge that. Does that resonate with you?
I think it resonates with most people. If you know, I think that, as I said before, I think that the advice that you have and that you're giving to people right now is the advice that they really need to hear. I think it's soothing, because a big part of the problem is that we're all dealing with something that we just don't know answers to. Our world leaders are still scratching their head, trying to do the best they can with what they know how to deal with it. You know, like we're screaming for shutdowns, then people are saying, well, it's going to ruin my business and it's going to ruin this and it's going to do that. So we're in a time of contradiction where people want something and then they're concerned about it. So, and I think, you know, we talk about this in a, if I can refer to this as a dog training application, we talk about, you know, the application of reward and punishment in that a dog won't reject it as long as it knows how to control it. If it understands the mechanism of control, so to speak. And I think that's what people are feeling that they're lacking in right now is the mechanism of control. They just don't know what they don't know. Yes, Mr. Cohen.
So our president, Melanie, was asking, can you give the viewers a little more understanding of who Miss Birdie is, people that do not know?
Birdie, go ahead. Give yourself a plug.
Tell us a little bit about more yourself. People that don't know.
My real name is Birgit Oshini, but everyone calls me Birdie. I'm from Austria. I've trained as a clinical psychologist in Austria. And I, till February, had my own clinical psychology practice in Sydney. And I have a side business focusing on emotional wealth in dog owners, because I very often feel that the emotions of the dog owner travel onto the dog, like emotional contagion. So I do a lot of workshops in regards to helping dog owners being more confident and aware of the emotions that the dog benefits, and helping them with grounding and mindfulness strategies. But since February, I've decided to venture full-time into the dog industry. So I've closed my psychology practice, and now I am currently developing online training tools for burnout prevention, how to stay mentally well for in the dog training industry, and just exploring new avenues. That's cool. And I'm sometimes on the Canine Paradigm laughing with Glenn and Michael.
A very welcome guest, may I add. And Tash Treves is saying, waiting on Birdie's guided meditation sleep series, it would be so soothing.
I agree.
Larry Crone is waiting on bated breath for Birdie to be sending him a little sweaty love song so he can go to sleep to it.
Well, I don't know. But I think coming back to the topic, because I know we have a time limit here, I just want to get through the model again. So the other strategies, and these strategies, they are founded on research models. Like, you know, this is founded on acceptance and commitment therapy. And I've created a model, short version called the PACT model, based on acceptance and commitment therapy. And in Australia, Russ Harris, and in America, Kirk Strosel, masters. So it's not just me, this foundation and framework.
But
sorry, Bertie. Sorry. Alex, I think it might be your mic. Where is your microphone sitting?
I think it's off.
No, it's not. I put you back on. How about this? I'll leave just you and Bertie here, and we'll step off for now.
Yeah, just give me 2 seconds because that noise is really.
Bye, Alex. See you soon.
Here we are. We're alone in the room now. Whoops. Whoa. Wait, what's happening? Going all over the joint. Okay. Sorry, Bertie. So give your business a plug too. Like talk about your business name so people know where to find you.
Yeah. I'm Pause in Life Coaching. I'm on Facebook.
P-A-W-S.
Yes. So as in dog pause.
Melanie saying thank you for explaining. She wants everyone to know who you are.
Thank you. Yes, I'm really excited that I can hopefully be part of the ICP conference. So it's going to be very exciting. Back to the model. So we talked about being in the present moment is important. We talked about accepting your emotions is really important. So they don't bottle up and then come out shooting, or that you don't have to engage in numbing unhelpful behaviors. Mm-hmm. And then the other part is that you choose your values. Values are things that give your life meaning. They give you direction. So they kind of are like morals or how you want to hold yourself as the best version of you. So, for instance, in times like this, the values could be kindness, compassion, love, staying hopeful, having time for people, being practical. Like these are all things that we can focus on. Instead of focusing on what doesn't work for us, we take control back and go like, hey, this is who I want to be. No matter what life jugs at me right now, no matter what challenges I have, I always have control over who I want to be in that situation. And that ultimately gives you freedom and hopefully it's not always easy, but it gives you authenticity, it gives you growth, it gives you like fulfillment essentially and inner peace. Because I do think that, it's questionable if the world will go back the way it was before Corona. So we have to go like, well, we have to be true to ourselves and bring the best version forward that the world hopefully afterwards is a good place and we improve and go backwards. So that's really important that you know who am I? Like if I had to define myself in values, what do I want to stand for in life?
Well, the world wouldn't hurt changing a little bit. I mean, having a world 2.0 wouldn't be a bad thing if we could reset some values and, maybe learn. I mean, just the hygiene thing alone. People learn how to be more hygienic and how to clean themselves better and, prep surfaces better and so forth. I think that would be beneficial. And maybe people will learn a little bit of patience and a bit of love for each other and see, and reflect on their terrible behavior when they're battering old women in shopping centers to snatch some toilet paper off them.
It's crazy. Like, I think at the moment we see that the world is quite a greedy place. This is what came out. And that's not a world I want to endorse.
No, that's right.
So I think this is really time to dig deep and go like, well, what's the best version of you going to look like? And you have to take responsibility. And that's the last point. You have to take action. So you have to not just talk about who you are. Like it's all nice and good to say, oh, I'm a loving person. I'm a kind person. Well, where's the evidence? You got to step up. You have to show. Like technically, a person that lives by their values, you don't promote your values. People just see them in your behavior. Like other people know your values because they are so strong in your actions and in your behavior. That's how it should be. And in times like this, taking action also means, like follow the WHO guidelines in how to stay healthy in times like with disinfectant and personal hygiene. Make sure your mental health is okay. Reach out to professionals in your country. Go to online resources are very, very prevalent at this time and place. And also just really every day structure yourself that you have healthy routines, healthy things to do, things that give you joy with your dog, like that you bond. Like this is a time where I don't have time is no longer available as a reason not to do things because most of us have more time. So use it. And I think that's really important to stay okay and resilient and, just be kind to each other, stay hopeful, do good things, make the world a better place. That's in the end the purpose of life.
Great advice as always, Bertie.
I don't know, but it's all I have.
I love hearing it and I never get bored of it. And that's from the heart. I'm pretty much a straight shooter. I tell people I can't hide my feelings from people when I'm not happy with what they're doing or saying. So, you know, I really appreciate you. I've got a lot of love for you. I know, you know, you've very much encapsulated the training community in a very short amount of time. It's because, like I said before, you are a very genuine person. You give freely and lovingly to people, and you know, we need you right now. You're I know you need things yourself. You know, there's times where somebody in your position, you need your downtime and your private time and stuff like that, but I know you need your people as well. And you know, again, as I said to Brent before, you know, having you in my life, if I'm being a little greedy and a little selfish right now, having you in my life is better because of people like you.
Oh, my life is better because of having you in my life. And I think that's the beauty of community. If it's done well, everyone benefits, you know. And I mean, you're family to me. And I think the dog industry is a family in itself. It's a very complicated family, but
it's a very dysfunctional family, but a very just an amazing family as well. Like, even again, well, if I'm going to plug the ISCP a little bit, which I enjoy doing for all the right reasons, but my family grew exponentially. Yes, you are essential, Marcia. I absolutely agree. My family grew exponentially when I joined the ISCP, and I met, you know, people from all over the world, and took on the role as the director of oversight for the EU committee and so forth. And, you know, meeting Melanie and all the crew on there, the Cohen and Scarpino and all those people, Rick. I mean, I could just go through and name every single one of them, but it's beyond that. It's the people that we met at conference and the people that we connected with. I mean, my God, it was just such a fantastic experience of meeting and greeting with all these people and listening to their stories and what they've done and where they've come from and what they're achieving. This is why I say to people, you know, like, conference is such a great networking opportunity. It's not just something that I'm just trying to plug for the hell of it. It was just such an honor and a privilege to be amongst some of those wonderful people. You know, and I appreciate really much Josh Moran, who, and, you know, Josh Moran and Alex Edwards, who was on before, who got me involved in it and really inspired me to be a part of it. But, you know, we have so much wonderful talent in this own country of ours, as people are now starting to see, you know, with the work that Pat's doing and you're doing and Sweats is doing. You know, we really have, and beyond that, you know, there's people that they haven't yet met that, you know, they're going to start seeing in the future. Some people coming through NDTF that I've had the honor and privilege of being a part of their introduction to the career. They're going to amaze the world with some of their talent and their ongoing passion for it. So, you know, we are really at a good level of being involved with an enormously wonderful community.
I so agree, and I think that's the way to go, is that we support each other, that we lift each other up instead of fighting each other. If the more strong we are, the better we are as a team, as a family, the better we will be as a collective. And I think, you know, the message today for me is, like, look after your community, whether that is your neighbor over the fence, whether that is your training buddies with your dog. Check in on them. Tell them not to give up. Support them. You know, like, altruism is never selfless. You always get something back if you help other people. So now's the time to stay kind to people and yourself. And I'm very happy that I found my community in the ISCP, and I love the dog training industry in Australia. It's my kind of people, so I'm very lucky to be here.
Thanks, Birdie. Really appreciate you, and thank you so much for being part of this effort today. And I want to bring Jason Cohen back in, so can you join us please, Jay, so we can have a chat to you. So stay on there, Birdie, and we'll bring Cohen in as well. Here he comes.
Hey, I'm back. My messy hair. Can't get a haircut.
I told you, your hair looks good like that. Jace, I just want to, you know, on our behalf, from the Australian collective, mate, and, you know, I don't represent Australia, but I'm very proud to be a part of this community, and it's something that I love, and I, you know, I'm very protective of. I love the people in it, and I love my new family in North America and beyond into Europe and wherever great people are coming from. But Jace, I just want to say, mate, since you came on the board and your efforts and what you've brought on and the initiative in doing things like this, you know, I've got a lot of love for you, man. I've only known you for a short time. I know, and I know that you're very expressive of that as well, and I appreciate you very much. You know, this was very much an initiative from Jason and Melanie, and the board got behind it and backed it, which I'm really thankful for, and giving me the opportunity to, you know, it was very much a privilege to be asked to host this today. Thanks, man. I can't thank you enough, Jace. Yeah, thanks, buddy. And you are, dude. You're making an incredible difference. You know, like your marketing, your graphics, how seriously, and your passion behind your job is. You can see it, man. It really is making a wonderful difference. So are so many other people. You know, there's some great people involved in this, not just in the board, but you know, in the subcommittees and you know, in the other groups that are involved in it. The work and the efforts that these people are putting in behind the scenes, I mean, it's incredible. You know, the people in the office, I can't say enough nice things about these people. They really are giving a lot of their own personal time to try and bring this to a world standard and really stand up and be counted for. So this is why I say to our balanced training community and anybody who really wants to get involved in it is become a member, support the ISCP, you know, create a legacy within each other. We really need each other now more than ever. You know, there's a fight coming and we need to be ready for it. We need to have well-educated, smart, pragmatic people behind this that are not in the fight just to be spiteful and negative, but to educate people properly, to bring real science to people, and to, instead of just flooding them with pages of pseudoscience, we need to be better educated. We need to get our facts straight, and we need to be raising the ceiling and then punching through that. I think I'll shut up now, man, because I'm chatting a lot. So I just want to say a huge thanks to everybody who joined us today. Yeah. So we've got Brent Dry, Nicole Smith, Amy Hayward, Scott Wendt, of course, Bertie Oshidi is still on the screen with us now, Jessica Torrance and Alex Edwards. And Jace, thank you very much, man.
Thank you, man. Just keep an eye. We're going to do one more of these for our European members. Want to hear what they're doing there as well. So keep an eye out. We want to support our global community, and we're stronger together. That was the idea behind this. Not just one-on-one. Our community can help the rest of the community. And as Bertie said, together we can really help each other out.
And everybody who watched and made time today to sit in on this and comment and join, thank you so much too. You know, you're a massive part of our community. It doesn't matter the start point or the end point or the middle point of where you are. Like, just keep enjoying it. You know, stick in there. We love you too, Mel. You've been amazing. You've been absolutely fantastic. And even when I was half dying on your couch in Virginia, so I can't thank you and your husband Jason enough for your genuine support of carrying me through Nelson's flu.
Awesome.
There's another thing I want to tell people before we wrap up. You need to watch The Tiger King and aspire to be everything but that. Because,
oh my Lord,
that thing watch is- it. Oof. And realize that we don't want our canine community to head in that direction, because there are some unscrupulous people that are in our community that emulate that. Please reflect on that and do anything but become those people. Yes. They start off for the right reasons, and then greed and ego corrupt them. It turns their heart black. And, you know, I love you too, man. Get some sun, you buffhead. Amanda from Maine, thanks for all your energy. Thank you, Amanda. Thanks for Kylie Bright, love you too. Thanks for all being there for us. Thank you. Tiger King, please watch it. But remember, this is not what we want to become. This is just not what we want to do. It's something we want to veer far away from. Watch it for entertainment factor, and, you know, pity these people, because, like I said, I think they really started in a good place but ended up somewhere terrible and, you know, sad stuff. And we've got so much to look forward to because we are being guided by great leaders in our community who are taking us in a better direction. And this is the wonderful thing, is that there are very good people out there who are now saying, you know, like, back yourself properly, have a good ceiling, produce good evidence, just don't go off hearsay and get angry and be quick to lose your temper. And there are certainly many people. Pat Stewart is one of those people who certainly helped me contain my anger and thoughts about things. Birdie is another one, and there's just a myriad of other people who've supported and listened to me and guided me, and you too have access to these wonderful people. They're out there, they're a part of your community. All you've got to do is make the effort to open a line of communication to them and get on board. That's it for me.
Come to conference. Okay. Thanks, all.
Bye.
Thanks, guys. Okay, so take care, everyone.
Later, guys. Have a good one. Thank you.
Thank you.